die. I don't want to celebrate someone dying, even though it was for me and it was for you. But we commemorate it. And we believe as Christians, still down in our hearts, that on the third day he rose again. And because he rose again, and this is the part I wanted to get to you from the beginning. You're in your 20s and 30s. You don't quite get it yet. A few weeks ago, I turned 73. When you're young, you're not thinking a lot about death, even though death can come at a young age. But you're not thinking about it. The older you get, the more it kind of stays on your mind. You start getting up in your 60s, 70s, and 80s. You know your time is short. Now you got to start really understanding, is it true when Paul said to die is gain? Because if you're heading down that road, you got to believe that the best is yet to come. And that as surely as God rose Jesus from the dead, he will rise us who have put our faith and trust in him. Let's give God one more great praise. And so tonight, those of you who had your foot washing and all done, and those of you who ate well, and now we're ready to go right into our worship service. I'm going to ask that you stand at this time. We'll be led in prayer by Assistant Pastor Jimmy Carpenter, our scripture by Minister Greg Adams. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. Have your heart pray. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we come to you praising your holy name. Praising you, Lord, because you are God. Besides you, there is no God. And we celebrate, hallelujah, we celebrate your resurrection. Yes, we commemorate this day here in your death for us on the cross. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to your name. We thank you, Lord God, for your plan of salvation. We thank you for your word. We thank you, hallelujah, for loving us and keeping us and caring for us, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, hallelujah, for just being there to hear our prayers, to hear our cries, Lord God, when we cry, when we're going through the tribulations that you said that in this world you will have tribulation. But you are with us. You want us to be of good courage. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, Lord. We ask that you be with this service, Lord God. Hallelujah. Be with those who are speaking your word, Lord God. That we, hallelujah, are encouraged, Lord, to go forward, Lord God, on this road, Lord God, that leads to eternal life. We love you, Lord God. Be with this service today, that your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen.
The word of God on this Good Friday evening is coming from the book of Isaiah, 53rd chapter, verses 4 through 7. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. The word of the Lord is already blessed. You may be seated in the presence of our God.
Thank you. and his glory above
the
nations.
We say the Lord is high above the heavens.
The Lord is high above the heavens.
And his glory above the nations.
And his glory above the nations. The Lord is high above the heavens.
Come on and clap your hands in his place. Yeah, yeah. And his glory above the nations.
And his glory above the nations.
We say the Lord is high above the heavens.
The Lord is high above the heavens.
And his glory above the nations.
And his glory above the nations.
The Lord is high above the heavens.
The Lord is high above the heavens.
And his glory above the nations.
And his glory above the nations.
Of the highest praise. I said he is worthy of the highest praise. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I know at most churches every single year they do the seven last words, which we have done here. Years ago, I came up with an idea to try to bring some variety to it. So last year we did do seven last words, and the thing about Victory that's so funny is the ministers here line up 1, 2, 3, 4. I mean, so we says they had seven last words and they each had 7 minutes. And we were out of here within that. I mean, everyone stayed in their time frame. I learned from my pastor, Bishop Brazier, when you go way over what you allow, you better enjoy it, because it's going to be a long time for people to hear from you again. So I came up with this idea called the cross and the crown. And so that has been working well. And again, they're just sermonettes, so they'll both be bringing short messages. But this is a great way to bring it together for us to combine on here Good Friday the cross and what that has meant for millions of people. Christianity is not dead. Yeah, we have people that, and we do have to work with our young people. Many of them don't get it, they don't understand, but that's how I started. I didn't start in church. I wasn't in church by the time I was 15. Couldn't nobody make me go to church. Most boring place in the world. Only reason I went, because if I didn't go, I'd get beat half to death. The only reason I went. But God knows how to move in a young person's life. And the next thing you know, nobody got to make you come to church. You come into church because God has done something for you. Because Jesus is alive in you. And so for our young people to understand why Jesus' death. Just let me say this. I hope I'm not stealing none of your thunder. But the theological terms that we use for this is that Jesus' death was both necessary and sufficient. That's the theological way in which we talk about it. Necessary meaning that the wages of sin is death. So God cannot lie. You can't just see a gray-bearded God that he's so nice he won't send anybody to hell. You send yourself. The wages of sin is death. God is holy, and what we miss as human beings, his holiness is far beyond anything we can comprehend. Even the angels in heaven with no sin are bowing down before his presence. And one day, you and I are believers, we're going to experience that for ourselves. We're not going to have to look in the book of Isaiah and get it. We're going to be right in front of him ourselves. So it was necessary. He paid the cost vicariously, substitutionary for your sins and mine. It was sufficient because all who put their faith in him are going to heaven. Did you hear what I said? All who put their faith in him are going to heaven. So even if you're young, you'll make it. But you get older, God has got it in a win-win situation. To live is Christ, and as Paul said, to die is gain. So the first part, our first speaker is no stranger here to Victory. Assistant Pastor Tracye Hutsona, along with her husband, Deacon Patrick Hutsona. They have been here easily 20 years. Yeah, easily 20 years. And they serve. They both serve. He works with our Taste of Victory and other ministries. He's a deacon. She has been working with our young people in youth church. We wouldn't probably have a youth church if we had not had Tracye Hutsona. And professionally, she is a principal. She's a principal at Hoof. Is that correct? No. Which one? Yes, Indiana School. She's a principal at Indiana School. So her day-to-day is a middle school. Is that right? That elementary. But my point is, this is why you need to find things up front. So you don't stand up here and be embarrassing myself. But the main point I was trying to make is she still works with kids. She works with kids and understands what's going on. And she shares with me what the breakdown in the family is doing to our young people. Because she sees it in how these kids act on a day-to-day basis that reflect things that are not happening right in their home, that they bring it to the school. So she is a dynamic preacher, dynamic speaker. She loves the Lord, and I know she has a great word for us on the cross. So let us stand and receive Assistant Pastor Tracye Hutsona.
Praise the Lord. Whew, you may be seated. Praise the Lord in Jesus' name. Thank you to my pastor, Pastor Andrew D. Singleton Jr., who I love and appreciate so much for this opportunity. Yes, we can give him a hand. Praise the Lord. And and I don't see Sister Singleton, but in her absence, I do appreciate her as well. I praise God for the first family, to Drew, who is a good friend and brother. I appreciate you. My brother's here, my big brother, Brother Thornton, pastor, as well as my bigger brother, Minister Sam, assistant pastor. I want to say thank you for your support, for your love, for pushing me. I told Pastor, I said, okay, Pastor, this is a stretch, because I've never preached about the cross itself. So you all pray for me. Amen. Amen. To my Victory family, thank you for all of your love and support. To my sister-in-law, who's always here and supportive. And I don't feel quite right on Good Friday calling him Big Daddy. I don't know. Something about that on Good Friday doesn't sound right. Because I do want to commemorate this occasion. But what I will call him, in light of what we've learned, is Papa Grande. Amen. That sounds a little bit better. And if you did not know, that's Mexican, Spanish, for Big Daddy. Amen. Amen. Deacon Patrick Hutsona, won't you stand? Amen. And we're going to get right into the word. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you thanking you, God, for this occasion. Thanking you for this evening, oh God. Thanking you, Lord God, for your life. The life of your son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent for our sins, oh God. Lord, we thank you for this evening. We thank you, Lord God, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart will be acceptable in your sight. Oh God, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. Amen. Our text is taken from Hebrews, the 12th chapter and the 2nd verse. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat at the right hand of the throne of God. He endured the cross. He endured the cross. He endured the cross. If I had to title this sermon, it would simply be Jesus Endured the Cross. As I read my devotion this morning, I came across these words. It was all real. The cross was real. The beatings were real. The lashes, and I'm not talking about the ones that we wear, were real. The blood was real. The thorns in his head were real. The mocking was real. The shame was real. The scorn was real. It was all real. But the Bible says that he endured the cross and despise the shame. My question tonight is how? How did he endure the cross when we struggle to endure even the simplest trials? As I prepared for this evening, I read all four gospels, Pastor, regarding the crucifixion. And I noticed a theme throughout all four. My conclusion was that Jesus and the cross represented his passion, his purpose, and his posture. Look at somebody and say, passion, purpose, and posture. Jesus' passion made him endure the cross. The word passion is from the Latin word patai, which literally means to suffer or to endure. As stated earlier, Jesus' suffering was real. He was God, but he was also man. He felt the pain of the cross. He even prayed in Matthew 26, 39, my Father, if it be possible, may this cup be taken from me. He was actually suffering mentally,
thinking about what he would go through physically on behalf of our sin. Today we use the word passion to denote strong emotion or even love. Because of Jesus' passion, his love, we now have the right to eternal life. Because of Jesus' passion, when we suffer, we too can come boldly to the throne of grace that we might obtain mercy and find grace in our time of need. Hebrews 4:16 says, because of Jesus' passion, he healed the sick and he raised the dead. Jesus' passion led him to the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. It was Jesus' passion that led him to cross cultural and racial barriers to ask the Samaritan woman for a drink and ultimately tell her that he was the living water, and if she drank, she would never thirst again. It was Jesus' passion that caused him to overturn the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves in the temple. It was Jesus' passion that led him to endure that cross. Woo, Jesus, so that when we place our faith in Christ for salvation, we die to our old selves daily so that we may live in Christ. Jesus' passion allows us, like in Ephesians 4:24, to put on our new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Look at somebody and say it was his passion. Oh, hallelujah. The next thing that caused God, Jesus, to endure that cross was his purpose. See, Jesus' purpose made him stay on that cross. He knew his purpose. The word purpose means the reason for which something is done or created, or for which something exists. His raison d'etre. Jesus knew exactly why he was born. He knew why he was created. Luke 19:10 states, the Son of Man has come for this purpose, to seek and to save that which was lost. See, he was created to die on that cross for the sins of the whole world. When I thought about it, I said, Lord, you sound like a mad scientist. How in the world would you create something that is designed to be destroyed? I wondered what things may have been created to be destroyed. Let me see. There's trash bags, there's charcoal, there's coffee filters. And you might ask, are we comparing Jesus to a trash bag, a charcoal briquette, a coffee filter? Of course not. Keep in mind, we're talking about purpose. Look at somebody and say purpose. The real purpose of these items comes through in their destruction. See, we can't effectively make good coffee if we're trying to keep the coffee filter from getting dirty. And I know this because I'm a coffee head. Look at somebody and say purpose. We can't have really good, tender finger-looking barbecue if we don't want the charcoal to burn down and become unrecognizable ash. Look at somebody and say purpose. See, Jesus endured the cross because it was his destiny. It was the reason for which he was born. Matthew 26:52-54 said, put your sword back in its place. Jesus said to him, for all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I can't call on my Father? And he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen this way? Look at somebody and say purpose. See, Jesus knew that he was the fulfillment of the law and prophecy. Matthew 26:56, but this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled. Go with me to Isaiah, the 53rd chapter, and the 4th and 5th verses. I do believe that was our scripture tonight. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was cursed for our iniquities. We're talking about purpose. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. Verse 7 said he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Now, you know that's hard for most of us. Hallelujah. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent, but he did not open his mouth. See, his purpose was so clear that when Judas came to him and kissed him in Matthew 26:49, Jesus was such a bad dude. He knew his purpose. He simply said, friend, do what you came to do. Amen. Hallelujah. Do what you came for. For when we recognize our purpose, it doesn't matter who comes for us. It doesn't matter who lies on us. It doesn't matter who perpetrates evil against us. When we recognize our purpose, we can say with confidence, devil, do what you came to do. Look at somebody and say purpose. Woo, hallelujah. Woo, I'm preaching to myself tonight. Hallelujah. 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 His purpose was so clear that when he had an opportunity to speak on his own behalf to the Sanhedrin, which was the teachers of the law, the Bible says that Jesus remained silent. How clear is your purpose? Do you feel the need to constantly defend your purpose? See, when you know your purpose, come on, somebody. I need somebody who knows their purpose. When you know your purpose, you don't have to say a word. When you know your purpose, there's nothing for you to say. Let them accuse you. I've been there. Let them speak evil of you. Let them speak ill of you. You know why you were created, and you know what God sent you to do. See, at the end of the day, I am a teacher. You may call me principal, but my purpose is to teach. See, I recognize why I was put on this earth, whether it's children or adults or even other teachers. I was made to teach. This is what God has called me to do. This is where my anointing is. So you got to know your purpose and don't waver from it. Recognize why you were put on this earth. Look at somebody and say purpose. Woo, Jesus. The third and last reason that Jesus endured that cross was Jesus had a posture of surrender. The last thing that kept him there was his posture. Posture denotes how you sit or how you stand. A person's posture says a lot about him or her. We know that when a person stands upright, stands up straight with their head up, we see that person as confident or a leader. However, when a person slouches, we see that person as awkward, clumsy, or maybe even lazy. See, if we have a posture of prayer, that's often on our knees, or a posture of humility. Luke 22:42 says that Jesus knelt down and prayed, Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Not my will, though, Lord. Yours be done. Why didn't you all tell me this thing was all over my neck? As I was reading about the victim's actual posture on the cross, I was horrified. See, I never saw the movie Passion of the Christ because I didn't think I could stomach it. I'm glad I didn't, because reading the details was enough for me. Per crosswalk.com, the cross was a public symbol of indecency and social indignity. We're talking about posture. Crucifixion was designed to do more than merely kill a man. Its purpose was to humiliate him as well. Look at somebody and say posture. It was intended not only to break a man's body, but also to crush and defame his spirit. The offense of the cross came from the fact that the cross itself, a visible symbol and physical embodiment of moral shame and aesthetic repugnance, was the instrument of death for him who claimed to be the Messiah and Savior. See, in ancient Rome, a soldier would raise his hand open as a sign of surrender. Ah, Jesus's posture on that cross. Woo, Jesus was a posture of total surrender to the will of God. This is also a posture for us to emulate in prayer. See, this posture signifies a total reliance on God, with my hands lifted up and my voice filled with praise, with a heart of thanksgiving. I will bless you, oh Lord, a willingness to give up our will. Woo, Jesus, and accept the will of the Father. It says that we're giving up and we're giving over to God those things that we can't handle. My question is, have you surrendered today? Finally, Jesus literally hung on that cross. And though he was in excruciating pain, as he was less and less able to bear his weight on his legs, his wrists, elbows, and shoulders became more and more dislocated. As that happened, his breathing became increasingly difficult. I want you to just take a deep breath right now. Jesus couldn't do that when he was on that cross. Ah, he was covered in blood and sweat. Scholars note that the pain from his two shattered nerves in his wrist exploded with every moment. And through all of this, he was naked. The Jewish leaders, the crowds, and even the thieves on his sides had the nerve to jeer him, swear at him, and laugh at him. See, Jesus endured the cross. His posture of surrender kept him on that cross, even though he had no sin, even though he was blameless. His posture stood for my righteousness. He took a stand with his posture for my sin. He took a stand with his posture for my healing. He took a stand with his posture for my deliverance. He took a stand with his posture for my peace. Jesus's posture kept him on that cross for me and for you. His posture was uncomfortable, but he was standing in my place before God. You see, Jesus paid the ultimate sacrifice. He endured the cross. He endured the cross. Woo, he endured the cross. It was his passion, his purpose, and his posture that caused him to endure. What cross are you enduring tonight? Ah, what cross are you carrying this evening? Think about your passion, your purpose, and your posture. And remember, if there is no cross, there is no crown. God bless you.
Wasn't that awesome? That was wonderful. Come on, give it up again, Sister Pastor Tracye Hutsona. That was just a tremendous, tremendous message. I got saved on April 17th, 1978 at the Apostolic Church of God. Before I was saved, out in the streets, partying and everything else. The day that the Lord filled me with the Holy Spirit, That's 46 years ago, coming up here in April. I have never looked back, never. But there's a point I'm making here. Sometimes I cringe when I see how we who call ourselves Christians can lie, can cheat, can cuss people out. Like, I don't get it. I'm not trying to say myself morally superior to anybody. I just don't get it. The Holy Spirit comes in you, and now your mind begins to understand that I was destined for hell. Yes, yes. And Jesus paid a debt for me that he did not owe. I had a debt that I could not pay. But the least I could do is live my life for him every day. And so even when we fail as Christians, we should own it and say, Lord, help me to do better. I'm not what I want to be, but I know I'm not what I used to be. Keep working on me, Lord. Keep working with me. Because that cross lays in that background of the incredible sacrifice that was made for us to go to heaven. Again, that was a tremendous, timely message. And while you're clapping, it's offering time here at Victory. For those you sharing with us online, I hope and pray you've enjoyed the message as well. It's just so rich here at Victory. We just continue to explode in our growth. And I think one of the reasons is we take this gospel seriously. When a person is born again and filled with the Spirit, their life is transformed. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove whether that is acceptable and good and perfect will of God. And from the very beginning, all those disciples, as I mentioned earlier in my sermon last week, they deserted him. Jesus forgave them, went and got them, and they went and spread the gospel all over the known world. And all, with the exception of the Apostle John, died for their faith, were killed for their faith in Christ. And they went everywhere collecting money. And some of the places they collected money for, like at Thessalonica and other places, these were not people that had money. Paul said, you gave out of your poverty. Now, he wasn't trying to say you take your rent money and give it. No, what he's trying to say is appreciative people are generous. People who understand what Jesus did now are not selfish. We want other people to experience what we've experienced, and the only way they can do that is that we give to this work. That's the only way it can happen. And so that's why I don't give long offerings in 20 minutes. I don't threaten you and all that, because either you come with a heart, I can't make you have the heart, but I love to tithe. Even when I didn't have hardly anything to tithe, God got my tenth. I was glad to give it, glad to give it. How about you? And here tonight, it's just an offering. You can give $10, $20. It would be for those of you present here tonight. As you leave, there will be baskets in the back, and you'll be able to give your generous offering unto the Lord. There are envelopes if you wanted to be recognized, and fill them out and put checks or money in them as you please. Those you sharing with us online, the information is there in which you can also participate. This is a great night, and we should be glad not only to receive but to give. And so I'll let you know, after the next speaker, who I'll introduce now, we'll have a final selection from our praise team, and then we will have Holy Communion, and then we will dismiss. And so I want to now introduce, I'm going to call him properly. Everyone around here calls him, hey, Sam. But, you know, when you stand behind here, you got to do it right. This is Reverend Dr. Seven Lofton III. And the men here know his story. He's gone through an incredible amount, and God changed him. And now God has caused his failings in life to change the lives of hundreds of men. See, sometimes you go and I go through things that once we recover for them, God sends us forth to make a difference in other people's lives. And we have always had excellent men directors. Started with Elder Armstrong. Where is he? I saw him in it. He did a great job as the leader of our men. Then Pastor Stephen Wright, he did a wonderful job is the head of our men. And now Samuel has done a fantastic job here. And we call it the basement. And the basement is so powerful here on Thursday nights. And I believe, when do we resume? I'm sorry. First Thursday in April, we resume. It's hard to believe. That room has 50, 60 men in it, around 50 men in it, full. There'll be another 40, 50 men online, and they don't miss. Because we deal with real issues that affect men's lives. We don't play around with, we don't sugarcoat nothing. Matter of fact, if you're sensitive, you don't even need to be in the basement. Because, I mean, we just call it like, if a brother is wrong, we just call him out. And some things they say about some of you women, y'all need the she shed. Y'all need to go on, go to the she shed. We go to the basement, y'all go to the she shed. But in the end, he has just done a fabulous job. He has, one, gone back to school, got master's degrees in divinity, already had multiple degrees, went back again and got his doctorate in divinity from McCormick Theological Seminary. And I'll let him talk about his wife. He got a whole lot of new things happening to him recently. But God is continuing to use him. So after the final song from our praise team, he will be our speaker. I ask that this time we bow our heads in prayer and that our praise team will come back up. Lord, we thank you again for the opportunity to give in kingdom building, to do a great work for you. Thank you for the tremendous message on the cross that we just heard and how we are grateful. You didn't have to do it, but you did. Satan, through the voice of the centurion, hollered while Jesus was on the cross in this terrible postured position. If you be the Son of God, come down. Prove it. He would not come down. Not because he didn't have the power. Not because he was nailed. No, love for us nailed him to the cross. And all he had to do was call on his Father, and five legions of angels would have come and defended him. But he knew his purpose, and he endured that cross for our sins and have given us eternal life and given us responsibility to share the gospel with others and to give of our tithes, of our time, of our talents, of our offerings, so that others can be saved before he returns again. In Jesus' name, we bless this offering again. Amen. God bless each and every one of you.
Love lifted me. It was your love that lifted me when nothing else could help. It was your love that lifted me. Oh, love, your love lifted me. It was your love that lifted me. And when nothing else could help, it was your love that lifted, it lifted me. Thank you.
name, let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of.
Let the church say amen. Let them say amen again. And one more time, amen. The crown. First and foremost, giving honor to God from whom all blessings flow, especially during this wonderful time of the Christian calendar. I want to give a special shout out and a thank you to my senior pastor, Andrew D. Singleton, Jr., for your leadership, your mentorship, and all that you do. To our First Lady, to the pastors, assistant pastors, officers and trustees, deacons, Victory leaders and members, my fellow ministers of the gospel, brothers and sisters in Christ, and friends, greetings. To all of my family, relatives, and friends from coast to coast, much love. So I would ask that you just pray with me real quick. Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this opportunity. As I stand behind this sacred desk, I ask that you hide me behind the cross so that your son be lifted up. For his word said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all people unto me. Have your way as only you can have. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let me start by saying this is not a resurrection Easter Sunday message. So please join me and the entire Victory family this Sunday morning at 9 a.m. and 11:15 a.m. for the Resurrection Sunday Easter service. Amen? Amen? But the premise of my message is this, because my dear sister, Assistant Pastor Tracye, did a marvelous job of taking us to the cross where our Savior died for you and for me. Amen? But now let us navigate from the cross to the crown. But in order to do that, we must visit the place where they laid him, the tomb. Because the cross is the demonstration of God's love, while the resurrection is the validation of an empty tomb that shows God's power. So my text tonight comes from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 9. But before I give you the text, I would say if I was going to give a title tonight, it would be, where is the crown? Where is the crown? And the word of God reads, got it. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb while it was still dark and saw the stone already taken away from the tomb. So she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, that would be John, and said to them, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we, that would be the women that accompanied her, do not know where they laid him. So Peter and the other disciple went forth, and they were going to the tomb. Then the two, that would be Peter and John again, were running together, and the other disciple ran ahead faster than Peter and came to the tomb first. And stopping and looking in, he saw the linen wrapping laying there, but did not go inside. And so Simon Peter also came, following him, entered the tomb, and he saw the linen wrappings laying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not laying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. So the other disciple who had got to the tomb first, John, then also entered. He saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise again from the dead. Where is the crown? For most of us, a conversation or a message about crowns is nothing new. In our society, we've come accustomed to the word crown. Let me give you a few examples. There's some of us in this room right now that watched 6 seasons of The Crown, which told the story of the reign of Queen Elizabeth. In a game of checkers, what do you say? Crown me. Back in my day, my uncles had this car called a Crown Vic, Crown Victoria. My uncles also had a favorite beverage, Crown. It was in a little purple bag that they gave me when they were finished to keep my change and dominoes in. Okay, I guess some of y'all had them same kind of uncles. In sports, a horse that wins the Kentucky Derby, the Preakness, the Belmont Stakes is declared the winner of the Triple Crown. In baseball, if a player leads the league in home runs and RBIs and the highest batted average, they said that they have completed the Triple Crown. And then there's the crown jewel, a prized possession, a prized asset, and I would ask you to put a pin in that right there, on a crown jewel. So I asked the question, what would you consider Jesus's greatest miracle? The Gospels record around 40 miracles Jesus did, turning water to wine, casting out demons, walking on water, healing the blind, crippled, leopards, even raising the dead. Yet I would submit to you that his greatest miracle is the resurrection, the crown jewel of Jesus's earthly ministry. The Apostle Paul wrote that if Christ has not been risen, then our preaching is in vain. And your faith is in vain, 1 Corinthians 15 and 14. But there's this miracle of the resurrection. Here, there's this Old Testament guy named Job that you might know about, and he proclaimed, he performs wonders that cannot be fathomed, miracles that cannot be counted. Job chapter 9, verse 10. But what is a miracle? Well, a miracle actually has two parts. There's the event and an explanation. The event is an unusual occurrence, often one which cannot be explained by normal forces that we know of. The explanation part of the miracle points to who stands behind the event and why he did it. Thus, in the New Testament, we discover that the resurrection of Jesus, the event, is explained, the explanation, as an act of God vindicating the claims of Jesus and exalting him to God's throne. Now, I know there's some people that may be viewing or maybe in the room right now that will say, everything you Christians talk about comes out of the Bible. Everything you talk about, the resurrection, the cross, it's all in the Bible. And if you didn't have the Bible, you wouldn't be able to support your faith or your claim. Well, I came by here tonight to just help some of those folks out, because I'm going to give you a source outside of the Bible. There's a guy by the name of Josephus, a Jewish historian, wrote concerning Jesus. Before I share what he wrote, let me give you what scholars have said about Josephus. He had the most essential qualification for a historian: a perfect and accurate knowledge of all the transactions which he writes about without prejudice to mislead him in the presentation of facts. For all the old dragnet folks in the house, only the facts, only the facts. Young folks are looking like, dragnet, what is that? TV land, my friends, TV land. So Josephus wrote after 60 years after the resurrection. So he's not one of those guys that wrote 1,000 years after, 100 years, 60 years after the resurrection. This is what Josephus, the Jewish historian, wrote. Now there, about this time, Jesus, a wise man, for he was a doer of wonderful works, that would be miracles. He was the Christ. And when Pontius Pilate, at the suggestion of the principal men among us, that would be the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the scribes, had condemned him to the cross, those who loved him at first did not forsake him, for he appeared to them alive again on the third day, as the prophets had foretold. There's your external source for those folks that don't like reading the Bible, from the historian Josephus. So we know that the crowning miracle of Jesus, of his earthly ministry, was the resurrection that was predicted in the Old Testament and reaffirmed in the New Testament. But Jesus' resurrection was not him just coming back from the dead, because we'd experienced that with others, with Lazarus. Rather, he rose from the dead to be the first fruit, a new kind of human life, a life in which his body was made perfect, no longer subject to weakness and aging or death, but to be able to live eternally. But if you're a Bible scholar, you may be confused. No, there is no confusion in Christ Jesus, right? But there's this puzzle about the resurrection morning. Because if you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, things don't seem to fit together. I got one angel, I got two angels, I got folks running this way, folks running that way. Well, let me help you out a little bit. That's why I came by here this evening. We all agree that the scripture is inspired by God, 2 Timothy 3:16. See, Matthew wants to underline the miraculous, but also explain the rumor that you'll read about that the body of Jesus was stolen. See, Luke stresses the fulfillment of the words of Jesus, yet the disbelief of the disciples. John, the beloved disciple, by focusing on a single character, Mary Magdalene, and her intimate discussion with Jesus, points out in the resurrection and later on the ascension of Jesus, the promises of John 13 through 16 are fulfilled. But you know, I was doing some research. You know what doctors do. That's what, you know, they send us to me like, doctors, you're supposed to do some research. So I couldn't come up here and disappoint pastor not doing any research. So there's a divine testimony versus a human testimony. So the initial report of the empty tomb came from women. Sadly, the testimony of women was not respected in that culture and time. As a matter of fact, the Greek word concerning the women's testimony is translated idle talk. Y'all know, well, okay, that's another. She said, Deuteronomy 19 and 15 directed that one witness is not enough to convict anyone accused of any crime or anything, an offense that must have been committed. A matter must be established by the testimony or two or three witnesses. Thus, we have Peter and John who meet this standard as they run to the tomb. But here's what I want to say for the ladies. Please understand that this does not discount the testimony of the women as it relates to the church and has been accepted and recognized in theological communities for centuries. Your word means something. But doing the doctor thing, I found something a little bit more interesting. At the birth of Christ, there were the shepherds in the field, and there was an angel. And he said, do not be afraid, I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Christ, the Messiah, the Lord. Well, the resurrection is the new birth. Yes. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not, same thing they said to the shepherds. For I know that you seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. Come and see the place where the Lord lay. And now go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. Now, while they were perplexed, over in Luke, two men suddenly stood near them in dazzling clothes. And then over in John chapter 20, verse 11 and 12, Mary was standing outside the tomb weeping. And so as she wept, she stooped and looked inside the tomb. She saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the foot, where the body of Jesus had been laying. Now, if you want to get deep a little bit, that sounds kind of reminiscent of the Ark of the Covenant, because I heard there's an angel on one end and an angel on the other facing inward. Where was Jesus? He would be what would be on the bema, on the mercy seat. So I got two angels on the seat where Jesus was. Okay, that's another sermon. So we have a divine witness. The law said I needed two or more, an established testimony. Those angels had seen Jesus be born and saw him. So we got these holy angels, heavenly hosts that declare. So God doesn't need the testimony of men and women to declare his goodness, for the heavens proclaim that Jesus is Lord, that he's King of kings and Lord of lords. Now, I know somebody's out there's like, wait a minute, preacher. You said the title of your message is, where is the crown? Where is the crown? Well, the resurrection is the crown jewel. Remember I said put a pin right there? The crowning event, but where is the crown for Christ? Because at the cross, they placed a crown of thorns upon his head. Now that he's victorious over sin and death, where is the crown? Because, you know, in the ancient world, the seat at the right hand of the monarch, of the king, of the ruler, was a place of honor. It was given to the victorious general or warrior, to a wise and faithful counselor. Apostle Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20, where he, God, raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, that every name that is named, only in the age to come, but in the one that is now. Make it plain. That's in the Old Testament. But to make sense of Jesus, one must look what God's revelation says about the many roles of the promised anointed one. He's a prophet, he's a priest, and he's a king. And death's inability to hold him symbolizes the total victory. Jesus is the only one qualified to share the very presence with God, distribute the blessings of God, and execute the judgments of God. Only Jesus seated at the right hand of the Father on the throne. But the question again becomes, where is the crown? Apostle John, the one you know who outran Peter to the tomb, the same one who saw the burial garments and believed, helps us out a little bit when it comes to where is the crown. If you turn in your Bibles over to the book of Revelation, chapter 19, verses 11 to 13, John said, I saw heaven standing open. There before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and wages war. His eyes were like burning fire. On his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dripped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. So where is the crown? I came by here to tell you this evening that the reason there is no one crown, because God has, Jesus has done so much that one crown is not enough. John said, I saw him and he had many crowns. But before I get ready to have my seat, every message should have an application. For the cross, our sins were washed away. In Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 7, Paul writes, but God, being rich in mercy because of his great love, which he had loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised up with him. Here's the application. The tomb is empty. I need to ask someone this evening, why are you still there? Don't bring your problems, don't bring your issues, don't bring your need, don't bring your situation, don't bring your fill in the blank to the empty tomb, to the graveyard, because the angels have proclaimed he is not here. He is risen. Do you know that you have complete access to resurrection power? Let me give you something else from the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 8, verse 11. But if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, dwells in me, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. In other words, you and I who have been foreknew, also predestined to become conformed to the image of his son, so that Jesus would be the firstborn among many brethren, and those whom he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he already glorified. By the way, I got some more good news. There's some crowns awaiting for those who love the Lord and are called by his name. So Jesus has a lot of crowns, but for those that love him are called by their name, I heard there's a crown of rejoicing. There's a crown for the soul winner. There's a crown of righteousness. There's a crown of incorruption, or imperishable crown, and a crown of glory. But before I take my seat, I was reading about this Reverend James Smith back in the 19th century, and he said this: Jesus passed through many trials, engaged in many conflicts, therefore he gained many triumphs, and now wears many crowns. He wears the crown of victory, for every enemy, death, sin, and the death have been defeated. He wears the crown of sovereignty, for he reigns forever. He wears the crown of creation, for all things were made by him and for him. He wears the crown of providence, for he sustains, supplies, and rules all that he has made. He wears the crown of grace, for he redeemed his people by his blood. He conquers them by his spirit, molds them by his truth, and will bring them all to his kingdom. He wears the crown of glory, for every one of his glorified people owe their honor, happiness, and blessedness to him. For everyone that has a crown will cast their crown at his feet, because we'll know that we're unworthy to wear them in his presence. He is crowned by his Father with a splendid crown and given a name above all names, that at his name every knee shall bend, every head shall bow, and every tongue shall confess to the glory of the Father that Jesus Christ is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. His crown is the brightest crown that wisdom has devised, that mercy has jeweled, and power has brightened. So I want you to join me in giving the Lord of Lords and King of Kings some praise as we gaze upon his glory and see that once thorn-pierced brow covered with the crown of glory, the crown of majesty, the crown that belongs to our risen King. Amen.
Come on, come on, come on. Another great message. The cross and the crown. I mean, we got both, did we not? We got the cross, we got the crown. And I tell you, I have been edified. How about you? And before we have Holy Communion, I just want to say a few words about it tonight. But I first want to open up the doors of the church for someone that may not be born again. You might have come here tonight just to give your life to Christ, and your spiritual birthday be Good Friday. For you, it would be really good because you gave your life to Christ. We will open that up. We have our pool is up there. You don't have to open it now. We just want to see if anybody is coming, because we will open it up for you so you can be baptized in the name of the one who died for your sins and rose again the third day. And he will, and we have hundreds of witnesses here tonight, he will fill you with the precious gift of the Holy Spirit, and you will have eternal life. Is there anyone before we move to Holy Communion? If not, let's give them both another wonderful round of applause. I was talking to someone today about victory and just how well it runs and how the Holy Spirit is so great in this church and doing great things. Oh, I see y'all got the communion stuff. I'm like, I thought they were getting an offering basket. That's a small offering basket. You gotta go back and find a bigger basket. All right, I'm with it now. This is for those of you who don't have communion elements. If you raise your hand if you don't have communion elements, because we will be taking it in just a few moments. This has been a wonderful evening, and I want to connect us for just about 5 minutes or so, or 7 minutes at the most, around all that's been going on that now is comparable to what we have shared tonight and what the Bible teaches. As we prepare for Holy Communion, I want to use it as the Last Supper for tonight, if I may. We know this is koinonia, close fellowship, but this is Good Friday. And Good Friday, Jesus has what is called the Last Supper with his disciples. So in Luke chapter 22, verse 7 and 8, it says, "Then the day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed, Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, 'Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover.'" But I want you to understand that at that moment, in the disciples' mind, they're doing what has been practiced for centuries, all the way back to the deliverance of the Israelites back in the time of Pharaoh, when 10 plagues were sent up on the nation of Egypt, the kingdom of Egypt, and Moses declaring, "Let my people go." It was that 10th plague, which was the death of the firstborn, that caused Pharaoh to say, "All of y'all get up and get out of here." So in the disciples' mind, that's what they're celebrating, because they offered the Paschal lamb at that time. And the thing about it is, now we have Jesus, who knows in his mind that he is the real lamb, the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Not only that, as Jesus is sharing with his apostles, they're not, again, fully understanding what's going on. Most of you have been in church many years. You have heard it said that when the blood was placed on the door of the Israelites, that when the destroyer, the plague, came, it passed over them. And all that were in the house, that's why, for those of you not familiar with our saying, that's why we'll say things like, "We're covered by that blood." We not inside a house. We are in Christ, covered by the blood. Now stay with me just a moment. And then from there, the death angel passed and people were spared. But tonight, what Jesus wanted his disciples to understand, for us to understand, God is getting ready to give up his firstborn. The firstborn of Israel were exempted from the plague. The firstborn of Pharaoh, the firstborn of all the cattle, everything that was firstborn died. Except all that were what? Covered by the blood. Jesus trying to help them understand, but God is not going to spare his own son, his one and only son, who had been in the bosom of the Father before creation. And once again, I hear the praise team in my mind. What kind of love is this? And so then, if you look in my text here from Luke, he says in verse number 14, "When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. He said to them, 'I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until fulfillment in the kingdom of God.' After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, 'Take this and divide it among you. For I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God come.'" Kingdom of God means the rule of God in all spheres. "He took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup
It's the new covenant now. No longer this Last Supper. No longer the Passover. No longer the old covenant, which is ruled by law. This is the new covenant, a covenant of God's grace that is instituted by the blood of Jesus Christ. He says, this new covenant, in my blood poured out for you. I say to you as Christians, how are we not in debt? This is why I always can tell immature Christians, they'll come to church, but the change church should make in you, they don't get it. They don't get it. But when you have the Holy Spirit, everything in you tells you, and this will be in my message Sunday in the 9 o'clock service, then we have an 11:15 a.m. service. But Jesus gives the answer to the greatest question that every human being has. And what is that? What happens after you die? What happens? Jesus teaches. Now, you want to hear the rest of that, 9 a.m. this Sunday, I'm gonna deal with that as a part of. I can't imagine how any pastor in the world can get up on Resurrection Sunday and not deal with the resurrection, the physical resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And so as we now prepare to come and partake of our own since Last Supper, y'all got two, because y'all ate pretty good out there. And you stay woke through both. I looked out on the audience. I didn't see nobody going to sleep on either one of you. That means y'all did well. They did well. Two very well prepared sermons. And I do want to say this, this is important. I love both of those sermons for another reason. Not only were they anointed, but they challenged our minds and our intellect. And so if you talk about being a preacher, it's called homiletics. It is the art and science of preaching. One of the things that preachers, especially in the black church, were known for was just in-depth preaching. Matter of fact, one of the definitions was preaching, a preacher was one capable of deep thought. We had that a few weeks ago in classic style with Dr. Arthur Price when he was here. On doing that justice piece, that was a class. I know some people didn't really like it, but they don't have the history of the black church. That thing was moving like that. I mean, you were dizzy at the end, like being on a roller coaster ride. But it comes from a deep relationship with God, a deep understanding of scripture, and the ability to pull it together is very, very difficult. And today we just heard two wonderful messages that challenged us at every level and had some sense of humor and connectivity to us. But now, after having had foot washing, after having ate, after having heard the songs, after having praised God, after having heard the word of God, now we go to our version of the Last Supper as Jesus now gives us the bread and body of Christ. I'm going to ask our ministers, do they come forward and face me? They face the church now or face me now? They face me now or face out?
No, they come forward and face out.
Right. Yeah, please come forward and face out. And, yeah, turn around. Face out. I said me. I had it wrong. That's the boss, the Pastor Thornton. But I want you to understand these elements right before we take them. There are many ways to look at the bread and the wine. If you were Catholic, it would be called transubstantiation. Transubstantiation means in that teaching, and some of you were ex-Catholics, it means literally Jesus becomes the bread and the wine. This is my body broken for you. So every time you take community, and I've read some of their scholars on it, in a mystical way, Christ becomes this again. So he's dying. I don't like that. Our teaching is called being a consubstantiationist, which means that Jesus' presence is with the bread. Jesus' presence is with the wine. But he's not dying in 100 million times this Sunday all over again. That's not happening. But what we need to understand is that what the Lord wants us to get out of this communion is that we don't forget what he's done. And I want to say again, I am proud of you who are physically here watching online, that you obviously by being here understand the significance of being in church as much as possible on Good Friday as well as Resurrection Sunday. You are to be committed, because we're saying here at Victory, Good Friday is not going to die, because if we lose Good Friday, next we're going to lose Resurrection Sunday. One leads to the next. So we're not going to lose either one, because we need both of them. And as we prepare to take Jesus himself, and Apostle Paul repeats it in the book of 1 Corinthians, as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you show the Lord's death until he comes again. The Christian hope, Jesus is coming. He's been coming for 2,000 years. He's coming again. So I ask at this time, if you have your communion elements, to please stand. Those of you who are sharing with us via Facebook, YouTube, sermon.net, whichever, digitally, we're glad to have you. If you have your elements, or some of you, come pick them up at the church so you can participate. I ask that you take them now. First, the bread. Jesus said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Jesus said, drink. This cup is the new covenant shed in my blood for you and me. Now let us give God some praise. Just as surely as he lived 2,000 years ago, he is coming back. I said he is coming back. And as I'm going to give the dismissal, but since our ministers are lined up here, just throwing a little curveball, let them pray. If any of you want special prayer during this time, since we have so many of our ministers up here, feel free after I dismiss to come down and they will pray and lay hands on you. Let us have the benediction. We thank you for a wonderful service that has been anointed. Not just a wonderful service, just a whole evening from the saints doing the foot washing and humble submission because you washed your disciples' feet, from enjoying a fellowship of a wonderful meal prepared by our staff, to the anointed singing of our praise team and playing by our musicians, to the awesome word of God that went off tonight and was done by both Assistant Pastor Tracye Hutsona and Reverend Dr. Samuel Lofton, and then to have Holy Communion, I'm here to say we have been fed. We have been fed spirit, soul, and body. Spirit, mind, and body. We are fed in every dimension. So take us safely home. Thank you for all the guests that have come to share with us here tonight. And let us all find ourselves back in our own churches, if we can be there. And if we can't, watching our churches online as we celebrate Jesus' resurrection from the dead. In Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. Amen. God bless each and every one of you. Yes. Oh, as you, yeah.